Hey, and welcome to the highlights of episode number 51 with Eli Block. Some of my favorite parts of this episode are when Eli explains orgasmic meditation, what it is, why it's so powerful, the benefits, and how it will change your life. I also loved hearing about why we need to release our sexual energy and what this can do for our health and life. But this is only a snippet of the juiciness that we dive into in today's episode. So to listen to the full podcast and get all the info in the show notes, head to melissaambrosini.com/51 right now. Eli, it is so great to have you on the show, and I'm so excited for today's conversation. Tell us about your journey and how you got to where you are today.
I started doing this work in about 2007, 2008. And so now I'm a 9-year practitioner of orgasmic meditation. I lead the men's program here at One Taste. So I go out and essentially talk about the benefits of what it is that we do. And I think everyone should know about, because I think it's really what's important.
For people who have no idea what it looks like, what orgasmic meditation looks like, can you just paint the picture for us of exactly what happens?
What happens is, because it's not actually a sexuality practice, we don't do it as a form of foreplay. OM is primarily, first and foremost, what might be best described as a consciousness practice. And what that means is that it's a practice which actually builds focus. It's not a place to go to kind of check out into like eternal bliss or like try to escape from what's happening. It's actually something which is meant to draw you into the very present moment. And the way that it does that is it involves two partners, like I said, and one person, the clitoris having person, undresses from the waist down. So doesn't take off any more or keeps on any less clothing than is needed. So they just take off their pants and they lie down in what's called a nest. And a nest is the orgasmic meditation equivalent of what you would use in some other practices, like a yoga mat or a meditation cushion. And it's the place where you do your practice, you set it up for your practice, and when your practice is done, you take it down. So it's a very specific physical context for what you're doing. So you set up a nest, which is usually a blanket that gets laid down on the ground and a few pillows to support the legs and things. So we'll say it's a woman. You know, I'm sensitive to how people, you know, describe gender. Pronouns are important. But for simplicity in this conversation, let's just say it's a standard heterosexual couple, whatever that means these days, right? So you've got a woman who lies down. She butterflies her legs open, and he will take a Zafu meditation cushion or something firm, place it next to her hip on the right side of her body. And then he'll sit down, he'll put one leg over the center of her body. So literally he's sitting at a perpendicular angle to her body. He's facing straight ahead. If he were to look straight down, he would see her genitals right below him. His left hand or his left elbow rests on his left knee. And there's plenty of schematics of this at onetaste.us, which is our website. As you can see it, describing it isn't always the easiest. And essentially, they follow a protocol. So it's the same every single time. Orgasmic meditation is always 15 minutes. It follows a certain procedure, you know, every single time, which we can talk about exactly why that is and why it's so important. But basically, he'll put some gloves on, some very very thin gloves, vinyl gloves, or, you know, some kind of maybe latex, if that's your thing, whatever. The only thing for both people to do is to put their attention on the point of connection between them. And in orgasmic meditation, the point of connection between two people is the clitoris. Well, that's the point on her body. The point on his body is the tip of the left index finger. And essentially what you're doing is you're taking the most complex set of nerve endings in the human body, the most dense set of nerve endings in the human body, the most sensitive spot that exists on any human body. So like on my body, there is no place that has the density and concentration and nerve count as the clitoris. Is the most sensitive spot you can find on any human ever. And then I'm pairing that with the most dexterous part of the human body. You've got more fine muscle control with the index finger than you do with any other part. And so you're pairing the highest degree of sensitivity and the highest degree of potential skill. I should say potential sensitivity and potential skill. together. And what happens is, well, there's a lot of things that happen, but both people put their full attention on the spot of connection. And really what we're talking about here is it's a stroking practice. And when I say stroking, it's like, it's not a rub, it's a stroke. And it's not a hard stroke. It's a stroke where if you take your finger and just place it, close your eye, and place your finger on the top of your eyelid, the tender tissue of your eyelid, and very gently stroke it, it's using about that much pressure. And the only thing to do during this experience is for both people to put their full attention on what's happening at that point of connection. So in regular meditation, you know, most of the focus practice is on your breath. Maybe it's a candle, maybe it's a mantra. There's a bunch of different styles of doing that. In this greatest practice of the world, you're putting your full attention on the point of connection between two people at the clitoris and the finger.
My husband and I have practiced Om, and it took us even deeper, which was so beautiful. And a couple of things that we noticed was how much we needed to let go of the expectations, the agendas, the outcomes, and how much I needed to surrender. Because like you said, it's not a sexual act. It's about letting go. It's about presence. Like, you are the most present you'll ever be. And it's such a beautiful, beautiful practice. And it's about receiving. It's about being wide open on all levels, which is what my next book is about. It's called Open Wide, The Radically Real Guide to Deep Love, Rocking Relationships, and Soulful Sex. And I dive deep into some of the benefits of opening yourself up on all levels. So what are some of the other things that other people have experienced when practicing Om?
People notice a lot of different benefits, chiefly among them, enhanced focus and clarity, more energy, more vitality, increased sex drive. Om really messes with your brain in terms of your sense of like giving and receiving. Most of the time when we're talking about giving or receiving, you know, we're essentially talking about a transaction. And whether we kind of like it or not, we're accessing what most people, what some people would call the dual mind when we talk about giving and receiving. So if I'm giving to you, well, then there's something that's being transacted. It's traveling from me to you. And then you've got something and I've got less of something. And people say, well, you know, with love, it's infinite. And so there's no way that you can ever give too much away or anything along those lines. And that understanding comes from what's called the non-dual mind, which is that essentially if I sit down and I'm stroking, and I'm actually doing it for my own pleasure, which is the instruction that we give strokers, is you have to be able to receive through your finger. Because it's funny, people say, you know, the practice is about receiving, and they sort of point to the woman. And I'm like, oh, actually, both positions in the practice are reception positions. I'll tell you one thing I hear a lot, and this is something I've been hearing a lot more and more recently. Women come up to me and they say, Eli, or I know I'm this woman inside. I've got this amazing woman inside. And I feel like I've been in my masculine for a really long time. That's what I hear on a regular basis is, you know, I've been in business. I've been, you know, sort of taking care of a lot of people. I feel kind of tired and wired. I keep trying to fill this sense of hunger that I have with, you know, the shopping and the consumption, but nothing's quite hitting the spot. But I feel kind of masculine. And what I think is really interesting and the thing people don't often see there, which after they start the practice, after they actually start, you know, this lifestyle, which changes, is that they're not actually masculine. That's sort of a funny misnomer. What they are is something else. What they are is what's called tumescent. And what tumescence is it's this funny word that in the 80s had this kind of a romance novel context, which was like, it literally means engorged or swollen in some way. And the way it would be is like, you know, he withdrew his tumescent member or something like that, you know, and like some cheesy romance thing. But it literally means just engorged. And what most guys don't understand, what most people don't understand, is that women walk around with a tremendous amount of unused sexual energy in their bodies. With men, it's kind of just localized to our genitals. You know, guys will talk about blue balls and things like that. What we don't realize is that you guys are walking around with some version of that all over your body all the time. This sort of like vague irritation, sort of like subtle irritation that unless you're moving the energy in your body in some way, doesn't really go away. And so it's what makes women irritable. It was, makes you guys sort of like sensitive and frustrated. Cry, frustrated, all these different symptoms. It's what we refer to as tumescence. And the interesting thing is that because masculine just sort of sounds like, it's just kind of like a, it just sounds like the closest thing to describe what she's feeling. Because usually the feeling is some sort of like lack of access to some kind of internal flow inside of her. That there's some kind of flow, some kind of, I've heard it referred to like almost like a juiciness or like a, what we would call like her turn on. Like this access to like that sort of joyful, bottomless part of a woman that's just organically there. She's lost some part of that. She feels rigid in some way. And that rigidity gets kind of, you know, she reads a few self-help books and sort of goes to some conferences or whatnot. And she goes, aha, I know I'm masculine. And it's actually not that at all. What actually happened is she's frozen, not masculine. And so what needs to happen is that, that frozenness, the sort of stuckness of all that sexual energy, it needs to get thawed out. And what's needed in order to thaw anything out is a regular experience of heat applied to the thing which is frozen. So orgasmic meditation is heat in a number of different ways. It's stroking. So it's literally, it's quite literally friction on the clitoris, and friction generates heat. So you're literally physically going to unthaw your genitals with this practice. That's one thing. And then the second is it's also mentally and sort of psychologically unthawing, because again, there's this very frozen notion of a woman in a position of giving, 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 sort of frozen in this position. And the practice reverses that. She actually has to begin to develop an identity of laying on her back consciously with the lights on, right? Not like your regular sex, you know, sex life where maybe you just lie there and check out, or maybe you just lie there and you're not quite sure what to do. So you, you know, start thinking about stuff in your head. Who knows what it is, but it starts to create a groove where her identity becomes receiving. And if your identity begins to include receiving, your identity can begin to include worthiness. And if your identity can begin to include worthiness, you begin to feel like you matter, that your desire matters, and you begin to speak more of your desires. You begin to correct people if they don't get it right from you, not from a position of lack or feeling like the world is happening to you, or that you're a victim in some way, but actually that your desire is important and it's needed to actually make the world work properly.